Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpan Singh, and we are going to start with our today's current affairs lecture. So today we are 15th of April 2021. All right, and these lectures are basically useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination conducted by the UPSC, okay, as well as other government competitive examinations also. For that, you have to read a national newspaper, like you can read the Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. For that, you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, where on the day-to-day basis these lectures are basically uploaded. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first is basically the monkey dactyl. The monkey dactyl is basically a species which is having an opposite thumbs. Okay, so this type of species have been identified. Okay, so fossils have been identified. These fossils are basically 160 million years old. So such type of fossils have been identified, and they are described as pterosaur, right? The pterosaur species are basically having, you know, some sort of a, you know, the big giant species of, you know, the flying bird. You can understood with that a flying reptile, big flying reptile, but which is having the opposable thumbs. These opposable thumbs basically gave such pterosaur species as a identification, you know, as a separate sense of identity, right? And that could likely to be earliest known instances of the limb that is basically found with that monkey dactyl. Okay, as I told you, it is also known as the pterosaur species, which are nothing but a reptile. Okay, and you can understood the type of the size of this pterosaur species having is just like a dinosaurs, but which is having basically, you know, a reptile feature. So this is basically also considered as a cousin of dinosaurs, and you can also consider it as a first animal after insects to evolve, you know, a powerful flight. So it is having also the powerful flight, which can also, you know, can also run like a reptile. Okay, and they evolve into various types of species over the period of the time because of evolution. Okay, if you want to consider the size of this pterosaur species, it is as large as the F-16 fighter jet. The F-16 fighter jet is basically, you know, fighter jet belongs to the United States of America. So it's having this type of size, okay? And other word as smaller as, you know, the paper plane. So it has the varied size from smaller to the larger, as large as F-16 fighter jets. Okay, and this new pterosaur species or the fossils basically discovered in China from the Taoyuan Formation in the Liangong, China. It is basically considered as 160 million years old, this fossil. And it has been named as Kungpangopteras antipolyketas, right? Which is nothing but an species having opposable thumbs. And it is also dubbed as the monkey dactyl, which is nothing but having opposable thumbs. Okay. Now, this word, which is known as the antipolyketas, this antipolyketas is a Greek word, which is also, you know, mean as the opposite thumbs. Okay. And from where its name basically arises, and researchers could say this could be the first discovery of pterosaur with having the opposable or opposite limbs. Okay, and if you see the morphology of the body structure of the pterosaur, you can also suggest that could also, you know, they have some sort of hands for the grasping. Okay, so that they started living an arboreal life. So for that particular grasping, they started using their limbs for that purpose. So you can see these are basically, you know, the species which have been discovered, their fossils have been discovered. So this having the opposable, you know, your basically limbs. So this type of, you know, species have been identified. You can also equate them as a cousin of the dinosaur, which is as large as the F-16 fighter jet. And it is also known as the monkey dactyl. Okay, and it has been found in China in Taoyuan Formation in the Liaoning, right, province of China. Okay, next, the group A S. The group A S is, or group A 5, you can say. The group A S basically, you know, is basically considered as the far right activist group or far right group, right? This far right group is basically having some sort of a enmity or some sort of a, you know, vengeance with the Muslim, especially the Muslims. So they are planning to attack on the mosques or, you know, some of the Muslim people in the Germany. So the group A S, which is nothing but a group of individual, okay, which are also considered as Germany's far right group, right, which basically started their journey, right, basically from a group which is basically having some sort of vengeance against the Muslims. So a trial of 11 individuals, which supposed to be belongs to this group A S, right, is also begin in the city of Stuttgart in the Germany. So these 11 members which are arrested, right, they are planning to attack on the mosque, okay, as well as they are planning to attack on the asylum centers as well as the German parliaments, because these asylum centers are also mainly consisting of the Muslim migrants, okay, and they are planning to attack on the mosque also, as well as they are planning to attack the German parliament, because German parliament is allowing them, okay. So according to the German government, the organization was founded by, you know, by few people in September 2019. The most prominent one was the Warner S, Tony E, Michael B, Frank H, Thomas N, Markel W, Wolfgang W, Paul Ludwig W. These are the founding members of this organization. This is known as Gruppe S. Okay. And the meeting as well as the merger which have been took place, right, at the instigation of the Warner S, who was basically also called as the linchpin of this Gruppe S group. Okay. The ultimate aim of this Gruppe S is to shake the state as well as social order, how they are planning to attack, right, you know, some sort of a on the Muslims as well as, right, on the mosque. So their main motto is to attack on the Muslims, on the attack on the mosque, killing and injuring several number of Muslims which are present in the mosque, okay. And their ultimate aim is also disturb the social order, right, by means of this civil war, which will be carried out in the Germany itself. Okay. And this group is also planned to attack on the political dissenters, right, who is having some sort of a, you know, the vengeance with, you know, with them, or who have some sort of a opposition with such group, who having the plan of attacking on the mosque and who is basically having the far rightist ideology, right, with respect to, you know, the political ideology. Okay, fine. So police basically are interrogating the 11 people who are basically belongs to the group A S. Okay, next you have the KGDWN 98/2 block. So it is basically a block which have been given to the Oil and Natural Gas Corporation Limited, which is a basically a Maharatna company. Okay. Now, this is basically a block to produce the hydrocarbons, right? So an Oil and Natural Gas Corporation, which is in Maharatna PSU, has called on the buyers to bid for the natural gas from the deep water field of the KGDWN 98/2 block. Okay, so the Oil and Natural Gas Corporation, which is basically having this block, has called on, you know, a bidding process for inviting the buyers for the natural gas productions, specifically from the deep water fields, right? And this KGDWN 98/2 block is located off the east coast of India. Okay, so let's understand first what is this ONGC. So ONGC is an Indian government owned corporation. It is a Maharatna company, right? And it is also having the multinational crude oil and the gas entity, right? And its registered office is in New Delhi. And it is currently owned by the Ministry of Petroleum and the Natural Gas, Government of India. Okay, now I'm talking about this KGDWN 98/2. It is nothing but the cluster 2 field, which is lies in the deep water KGDWN 98/2 block. Okay, now it is located off the shore of Godavari Delta. So it is located off the shore of the Godavari Delta. Okay, and on the definitely the Godavari Delta lies on the east coast of India. Okay, And basically, it is, you know, having the water depth ranging from 300 meters to 3,200 meters. So it's the bearing depth. Okay. And this block, which is currently known as KGDWN, covers an area of around 7,294 kilometer squares of the Krishna Godavari basin, which is basically going to explore for the purpose of this, you know, the natural gas. Okay. And Oil and Natural Gas Corporation is basically the current block operator. And this ONGC, basically, which is a current block operator, have invited the bidding process for inviting the buyers for the purpose of production of the natural gas from this deep water field. Okay. And, you know, once this is getting ready, the ONGC is set to supply around 2 million metric standard cubic meters per day of the natural gas from the fields, which is starting at the end of June, right? And as you know that the ramping up of this production is basically done by the ONGC, okay, which is also the key government plan to boost definitely the domestic production, because we are heavily dependent on the imports for our meeting our hydrocarbon needs. Okay, so this block, once ready, is going to expect it, right, to reach to the peak production of 15 MMSCMD by 2024. Okay. And, you know, once this would be ready, this would account for around 20% of increase in the company's current production level, right, of around 70 MMSCMD, right? The natural gas, which is basically produced from this Krishna Godavari basin, which is also a part of the KGDWN. Okay. Now, this is a key part of India's plan to diversify, you know, first of all, its production capability, as well as to reduce the import dependence, right, by boosting the domestic production from such. So what is this MMSCMD? I told you already, it is million metric standard cubic meters per day. Million metric standard cubic meters per day. It is basically a short form for this. Okay. And India currently imports about half of its natural gas requirement. That is around, you know, 175 million metric standard cubic meters per day, that is MMSCMD. So it is the currently India's the natural gas requirement for domestic purpose is around 175. Now India is currently importing around half of this, you know, natural gas requirement. Okay, and it is, I was talking about this Krishna Godavari basin. From there, this KGDWN 98/2 block is going to be explored. Okay, next you have Manas. See, Manas is basically an app which have been, you know, launched by the principal scientific advisor to the government of India. Okay. Now, the principal scientific advisor to the government of India has launched this app. The ultimate purpose of launching this app is to promote the well-being across the age groups, right? Ultimate purpose is to well-being, right, across the different groups. Now, this Manas, which is also the short form for the mental health and normalcy augmentation system, which is also known as Manas, it is an app, right? And it has already been endorsed by the national program as a national program by Prime Minister Science Technology Innovation Advisory Council. Okay, now the Manas, which is basically, you know having the goal of promoting the well-being across the different age groups, is a basically comprehensive, scalable and national digital well-being platform. Okay, and obviously this platform or this app would augment the mental well-being of the Indian citizens in our country. All right. So let's understand what is this, the Prime Minister's Science, Technology and Innovation Advisory Council. This is most important for our current affairs point of view. So Prime Minister's Science, Technology and Innovation Advisory Council is basically an overarching council, okay, that facilitates the principal scientific advisor's office to access the status in the specific science and technology domains, right, as well as to comprehend the challenges in the hand, to formulate specific interventions, to develop a futuristic roadmap, and to advise the Prime Minister accordingly. Okay, the Office of Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India basically coordinates, right, to facilitate and ensure the implementation of the significant interventions by the concerned government department, as well as the agencies or the ministries. So you can say that this PMSTIAC, that is Prime Minister's Science, Technology, Innovation Advisory Council, Secretariat is based at the Invest India, right? And it is definitely provides the support to the office of, you know, the principal scientific advisor, which is also known as PSA, on the project management, as well as monitoring of, you know, different type of intervention. Just now I have mentioned, for example, you know, the science and technology domains, comprehending challenges, formulating special, you know, interventions, developing the futuristic roadmap, and so on and so forth, as well as other national missions. Okay. So this MANAS app would basically integrate the health and the well-being effort of the various governmental ministries, okay, which is basically belongs to the various, you know, the department also. And it will also having the scientifically validated indigenous tools with different interfaces, which is developed by various national bodies and the research institutions. Okay, through that, it will coordinate to the different users. And the MANAS was initiated by the Office of Principal Scientific Advisor to the Government of India. And it is jointly executed by the prestigious institutes called the NIMHANS Bengaluru, Armed Force Medical College Pune, and CDAC Bengaluru. Okay. Next, the National Commission for the Scheduled Caste, that is NCSC. Now, you must understand the NCSC is basically a constitutional body. The constitutional body means it has been set up by the constitution itself. Okay. Now, it has been set up under Article 338A. Right, under Article 338A, the National Commission for the Scheduled Caste has been set up. Okay, now what is happening is because of this coronavirus pandemic, right? The grievance or the, you know, the filing of the grievance with N National Commission for Scheduled Caste is getting difficult. So the Government of India has launched the online grievance management portal of the National Commission for the Scheduled Caste. So it will be an online grievance management portal. Okay, now the ultimate purpose of this portal is to make it easier for the scheduled caste population to register their complaint, right, from any part of the country, right? So it will be easier for them to register their complaint regarding any sort of a discrimination they face in the country. Okay, and this portal is basically designed with the collaboration with basically, you know, the Bhaskaracharya Institute for Space Applications and Geoinformatics, which is a center of excellence under Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, right? And this National Commission for the Scheduled Caste was set up, obviously, I told you, under Article 338, right, of the Constitution, which is a basically a constitutional body. Okay, the ultimate objective is to investigate, right, to look into and to monitor all issues which are related to, you know, the grievances related to, you know, any sort of discrimination against the scheduled caste population, and to safeguard, right, all provisions which have been given to the scheduled caste by the constitution under the law, right, for the timing which is in force, right? So it will look after all such complaints, investigate all such complaints, right, to recommend certain measures, right, for the purpose of enforcement of those, you know, the violated rights belongs to the scheduled caste population. Okay. Next, the hydrogen sulfide. As you know, the hydrogen sulfide is basically a poisonous gas, right? It is also corrosive and flammable gas. It can catch, you know, it can catch the fire. So it is poisonous, corrosive, and flammable gas, right? And as you know that from where it is produced from the swampy areas that you might have seen where, you know, you don't have the exit for the water, and it is basically, you know, a swampy-like conditions, or it is also produced from the sewers, right? So the scientists have developed an electronic nose, right? This electronic nose will identify, you know, the hydrogen sulfide gas. So this electronic nose will have, you know, the biodegradable polymer and the monomer, right, which can basically detect, right, this hydrogen sulfide gas, which is basically released, right, with the biodegradable polymer and the monomer that can basically detect this gas. So the H2S is basically a primary gas, which is basically produced from the breakdown of organic matter. Because you must understand, in the swampy areas, right, there is, you know, obviously, the, you know, some sort of organic matter is also getting collected. Now, once this microbial, you know, disintegration or the breakdown of this organic matter occurs, obviously, in the swampy condition, you will have the paucity of oxygen, or you will have the absence of oxygen. So there will be a breakdown of such organic matter in the absence of oxygen. That is also called as, you know, you know, you have, you know, some sort of a, you know, in the absence of oxygen. Okay. And that necessitate the detection of these gases, specifically from the sewers and the swampy areas, because that will be disturbing to the health also. Okay. Now, this challenge, right, is also bigger for purpose of detection of this hydrogen sulfide. So the Center for the Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, which is located in Bengaluru, which is an autonomous institute of, you know, Department of Science and Technology, have developed this electronic nose, which is an exceptionally sensitive and selective H2S gas sensor, right? So it is being developed by the Center for the Nano and Soft Matter Sciences, right? And this gas sensor would develop by impersonating a neuron which is responsible for identification of, you know, some sort of airborne molecules which belongs to the hydrogen sulfide gas. Okay, now this fabricated sensor, which will basically try to, you know, detect the hydrogen sulfide, will consisting of the heterostructure, right, which consisting of the two layers, right? These two layers, one is top layer and another is basically the bottom layer. The top layer is basically a monomer, right, which is having some sort of a chemical, you know, which is also known as ketohydrazole, okay, which is basically, you know, the top layer, which is also porous and which contains the hydrogen sulfide specific functional group, which can basically detect the hydrogen sulfide, right, once it attached with that top layer. The bottom layer is basically an active channel layer, right, which is basically, you know, having play in terms of the altering the current and the mobility of the charge carriers, which will also identify the hydrogen sulfide gas. So here, the hydrogen sulfide gas, which is also injurious to the health, right? It is just a warning for that purpose. Okay. Next, you have the hydrogen economy, the Indian Dialogue 2021. As you know that, hydrogen is a clean fuel, right? Now, every government in the world is trying to have the hydrogen fuel because obviously, they have to cut down the dependency on the petroleum or crude oil, right? Simultaneously, they have to produce this cleaner form of the fuels for the economic development. So the hydrogen economy, the Indian Dialogue, which was carried out in the virtual mode on 15th April 2021. So the Energy Forum and the Federation of Indian Petroleum Industry, both under the aegis of Ministry of Petroleum and the Natural Gas, Government of India, is organizing a round table, which is known as the Hydrogen Round Table, which is also titled at the Hydrogen Economy, the Indian Dialogue 2021, that will be carried out on the 15th April 2021. Now, let's understand what is this, the Energy Forum. See, this Energy Forum is basically an independent non-partisan think tank. It is an independent non-partisan think tank that conduct basically some sort of a intensive research analysis, as well as it will also consult on the functions, right, operations, as well as the government operations on the global energy markets. And the second one, which is Federation of Indian Petroleum Industry, which is also known as FIPI. The Federation of Indian Petroleum Industry is an apex society of the entities in the hydrocarbon sector. Okay. And it will basically act as a, you know, industry interface, right, you know, with the government as well as with regulatory authorities, right? And it will definitely help in the resolution of the different issues, and it will also shape, right, the evolution of the policies and regulations with respect to the hydrocarbon sector. Okay, next, the Hydrogen Roundtable, which is basically, it's a first of its kind, right, that will have basically the high level ministerial session. So here the ministerial sessions will be there, and that will be followed by the 5 panel discussions, right? And in that 5 panel discussions, you will have the eminent policymakers. You will also have the participation from the experts. You will have the participation from basically, you know, industry leaders, you know, they all will participate in this panel discussions, right? And these experts, industry leaders, policymakers are basically from the different geographical regions of the world. Okay, the ultimate focus on basically on the policy roadmaps, the mapping of demand and the supply of hydrogen specifically for the energy. Okay. And this high level roundtable conference will be led by Sri Dharmendra Pradhan, who is currently the Union Minister for the Petroleum and the Natural Gas and the Steel Government of India. Okay. And a separate session is also devoted to the India Hydrogen Mission for that purpose, right? Which also looks like as if it is very, very important for the energy purpose also. This hydrocarbon or hydrogen roundtable will have 25 panelists. Okay. These 25 panelists belongs to the 15 countries. That means 15 countries are participating in this hydrogen roundtable. Okay. And that all countries or all panelists will be discussing the potential of hydrogen from the multiple sources, right? And how it is basically relevant to the national energy transitions, specifically for the energy recovery, right? The objective of roundtable is to definitely to understand the progress of the hydrogen ecosystem across the continents in the different countries, and to coordinate, you know, some sort of a, the coordination among the different think tanks, governments and industry, so that they can join hand for the developing of some sort of an innovative technology that is sustainable, right? And that is much affordable, right? Much cheaper rate, so that such type of technological development can also boost the hydrogen economy, right, across the world. Okay, so this is hydrogen economy, which can basically fuel, you see, basically transportation, right, which can generate the energy. It can also fuel the cars, transportation, right, monorails, buses. It can also, you know, it is much cleaner fuel. Okay, next, the traditional New Year. As you know that, just now we have celebrated, right, our traditional New Year, that is also known as Ugadi, Gudu Padwa, Chetra Sukladi, Cheti Chand, Vishu, right? Then, your Puthandu, Buhag Bihu, different names are there, you know, from different sections of the society. Okay, so various regions of our country are celebrating our traditional New Year. Okay, so it is basically, according to lunisolar calendar, it is the first day of full moon of Chaitra, which is a month in the beginning of Hindu New Year. So it is the first day of full moon, right, of the month of Chaitra. Now, the people of Andhra Pradesh and the Telangana, they call it Ugadi. Okay, if you go to Karnataka, they call it as Yugadi. Okay, if you go to Maharashtra, they call it as a Guru Padwa. If you go to Tamil Nadu, they observe at a, you know, Puthandu. If you go to Kerala, they will celebrate it as a Vishu. If you go to Punjab, they will say it as a Vaisakhi. If you visit Odisha, they call it as a Pana Sankranti. Okay. And in West Bengal, it is known as the Poila Boishak. In the Assam, they are also known as the Buhag Bihu. Okay. And as it is one of the most important festival, which is also known as the traditional New Year, for that occasion, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi has extended his greetings, right, on the beginning of the new Sambat year 2078. Okay. And wished all the people for happiness and joy for everyone's life. Okay, so you can see here the different names which are known, right, in the different regions. Okay, next you have the Gyanvapi Masjid. See, this Gyanvapi Masjid is located in Varanasi. Okay, now there is a conflict. There is a, some sort of a conflict between, the Gyanvapi Masjid as well as, you know, one temple which is lying nearby, or which is lying adjacent to this mosque, which is Kasi Vishwanath Temple in the Varanasi. So what happens is there is some part of this mosque is basically, you know, have constructed recently, which shows some sort of a overhanging type of situations or some sort of extended part. So what happens is, you know, a trial court have recently asked the Archaeological Survey of India to conduct a physical survey of the mosque compound, right, to ascertain whether is it true to that allegation which have been put, that some sort of the structure have been built that is basically nearby the Kashi Vishwanath Temple, which is adjacent to this Gyanvapi Mosque. So here, with the authorization of this local court to Archaeological Survey of India to conduct the physical survey of this Gyanvapi Masjid or mosque, right? The managing committee of the Gyanvapi Mosque, as well as the Uttar Pradesh Sunni Central Wakf Board, both have moved to the Allahabad High Court, right, to restrain these proceedings of the local court, which basically recently, directed the Archaeological Survey of India to conduct this survey of the mosque. So, first of all, a senior fast track court civil judge known as Ashutosh Tiwari on April 8 directed, the Archaeological Survey of India to conduct a survey of the Gyanvapi Mosque, right, to which is basically lying adjacent to the Kashi Vishwanath Temple, right, to find out or to ascertain whether it was some sort of a superimposition or alteration or addition, right, any sort of a structural overlapping of any kind, right, on any other religious structure. That means whether it has some sort of a construction with respect to the mosque site, which is also superimposition, alteration, or addition on the Kashi Vishwanath Temple. So this survey will be carried out by the Archaeological Survey of India and to, file and report for that purpose. So the committee would basically trace whether any Hindu temple over existed before the mosque was built or superimposed at the site, right? So it will look at both of these angles at that point. So you can see here, both mosque and the Kashi Vishwanath Temple, both are lying adjacent to that site. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.